Jai Radha Madhava, Jai Jaya 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 J Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. दीनबंधो जगत्पते गोपेश गोपी ककंत राधकंत नमोस्तुते तप्त कांसान गौरंगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी विश्वान सुत देवे प्राण मामि हरि प्रिये वंश कल्प तिरुव्य कृपा सिंधुव्य च पतितनां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः श्रीकृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभो नित्यानन्द श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवासनि गौरभक्तवृन्द हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम हरे राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, after taking sannyas, had by trick of Nityananda been brought back to his own residence. Although Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had no intention of returning home, because a sannyasi traditionally will not return home, Nityananda manipulated him. And when Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was in ecstatic love of God, he was not paying so much attention to the road. So then Nityananda saw some cowherd boys. And these cowherd boys, they were very nice. It is said they were living very close to the Ganga. And because of the breezes of the Ganga, these cowherd boys were naturally devotees. So when Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu saw them, he said to them, chant the name of the Lord. And immediately those boys were chanting and chanting. Then Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu became very ecstatic. And he closed his eyes and went into a deep, deep meditation on Krishna. Then Nityananda came from behind, quickly went to the cowherd boys and said, "Psst. You see that sannyasi? This sannyasi is not okay. Something not okay." The boys were looking and saying, "Yes, he is not okay." So then Nityananda said, when he asked for the way to Vrindavan, point that direction and say, straight on, yes. So like this, the boys did it. So Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was sent in the direction of Vrindavan, but it was not Vrindavan. Well, he came to the Ganga and he thought, the Yamuna, I have come to the Yamuna. But meanwhile, Nityananda had sent a message to Advaita Acharya that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is coming just on the bank of the Ganga, opposite of Shantipur, right opposite of your house. You come by boat and then you collect him. So Advaita Acharya came and Lord Chaitanya saw Advaita Acharya. He said, Acharya, what are you doing in Vrindavan? How did you know I was in Vrindavan? Yes, my lord, wherever you are is Vrindavan. Yes. Yes, I'm taking my bath in the Yamuna. Yes, my lord. On that bank, the Yamuna is indeed flowing. And so they say, because Ganga, actually there is a Triveni there. So there are different rivers flowing, and on one bank there is Yamuna flowing. So they say. So yes, you're taking bath in Yamuna. But I have brought you some dry cloths since you have been bathing, and since you took sannyas for 3 days, you have not accepted any alms. So why don't you accept some alms in my house? By then, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu began to understand, I have been tricked, I have been cheated by Nityananda. But it was too late. He came to the house of Advaita Chai, and Advaita Chai said, I have cooked just a little bit of sak and a handful of rice, just suitable for a sannyasi, just very little. Oh, yes, so when he came there were huge quantities of prasada, enormous. And not only was Lord Chaitanya there, or Advaita Chaya there, but all the residents of Navadvip had been called, and everyone was there. It's like one of those surprise birthday parties. You come home, the light goes on, and, you know, imagine in this house it would be someone's birthday. They have no idea. They come home, they walk in, the light is off, and when it goes on, we go, hey, whoa! Something like that, you know. And everyone was there. And his mother was on the way. Oh, no. Yes, she was on the way. And Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, yes, my dear mother, I know it was a big mistake. I don't know how I could leave you, how I could take sannyas, how could I do this? But I did it somehow or other. Now what to do? Now if I stay home, I will be criticized. Therefore, you decide. So then she asked Nimai, stay here for some days. Nimai said, all right, I will stay for some days. Then she said, I beg one boon of the Vaishnavas, and that boon is that only I will do the cooking. And she cooked. She cooked for Nimai. It was the last time that she cooked for Nimai, and she knew it very well. And she cooked like she never cooked. She cooked with so much love, it was just inconceivable. And afterwards, the remnants of that cooking, that prasadam, the devotees had never tasted such prasadam. Never, ever. Because, you know, there is prasadam and prasadam, if you know what I mean. You know what I mean? There is prasadam and prasadam. If you know what I mean. It's not that. It's just a matter of ringing a bell, you know, ting, 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 ping, prasadam. No. It's the bhakti that is in there. And Mother Yasoda's bhakti was just overflowing in whatever she cooked. And everyone who took that prasadam was rolling on the floor, said, this is prasadam, this is ecstatic. In this way, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had returned, and all the devotees were there. In the Chaitanya Chandradoy Natak, at this point, there is a little story. And that story is that one day Ganga came to her husband, the ocean. And she was in an agitated state, very disturbed. So he said, don't worry, calm down, everything is all right. She said, you always say everything is fine, everything is all right. Don't you know what is going on? He says, well, what is going on? What is going on? Don't you know, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has left. I said, yes, he left. That is true. But he also came back. He came back to Shantipur, to the house of Advaita Acharya. He says, Ganga, you never know anything. You never know what's going on. Don't you know? Don't you know that he has already left the house of Advaita Acharya? Left the house of Advaita Acharya? No. Where is he gone? You never know anything. He has left Shantipur. He has left Navadvip. He has gone to Puri. Puri? Puri? Said the ocean. Oh, then he's taking bath in my waters. Oh, that is very good. Then he will take bath in my waters. And you, my dear wife, you don't have to worry about anything because the wife gets 50% of the credit of the husband. So there is nothing to worry. Everything is fine. And Ganga walked away, so that he did it again. Somehow or other, yes, she had no answer to that. So, and Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had gone to Jagannath Puri. And why did he go to Jagannath Puri? Because his mother had asked him to go to Jagannath Puri. She said, if you go to Jagannath Puri, Navadvip and Jagannath Puri, they are like two rooms in one house. Because the residents of Puri, they always come to Navadvip, and the residents from Navadvip, they always go to Puri. In this way, I'll get some news from you, my Nimai. So you go to Puri. So in this way, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to Jagannath Puri. Yet he had a mission. He had a mission to accomplish. And for that mission, he chose his associates. He sent Rupa and Sanatan to Vrindavan. And they resided there in Vrindavan. Chakta Purnamasi Samandala Patisinim Sada Tuchavat. They used to be very powerful government leaders living in royal palaces practically in great opulence with gold and jewels and so many servants. And now they were living in simple loincloth under a different tree every night. Not even the same tree. No, different tree every night. You might think, oh, it's all right to live under a tree, nice and comfy. My tree is a very, very nice tree, but different tree every night. Tough. But they were not in the mood of performing austerity. It was not in the mood of tapo divyam putraki yeda sattvam sujityas mat brahma sukhyam tanantam. It was not in that mood of performing tapo divyam, austerity for the sake of self-realization. So many yogis over the millennia have entered into the forest, into the Himalayas, where it is cold. You thought Melbourne is cold? It is nothing. Nothing compared to Himalaya. Very cold. Who can stay there? Even in summertime, if you go high enough, it's cold. Even in hot season, you go in the hot season up to Badrinath, and just at Jyotirmath they sell blankets. And you think they're selling blankets? You're still melting of the summer heat, but a few hundred meters higher. Ho ho, you wish you had bought a blanket. It's freezing. Of course, we bring Australian jacket. No problem then. So in this way, we manage. So many yogis are performing tapasya. Tapasya has for long been equated with the spiritual path. Bhagavad Gita also says that tapasya is performed, it says yagyadanas tapascha pavaninam manisinam, that even those who are saintly are becoming purified by yajna, danas and tapas, by giving performing sacrifice, by giving in charity, and by performing austerity. But the six Goswamis, especially Rupa Sanatan, they went first. They were not interested in tapas, austerity. What austerity? But Rupa Goswami, but Sanatan Goswami, you did not eat anything. Did not eat anything? No, nothing. For 48 hours you did not eat. Did not eat? What? Krishna, 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 Krishna. Did not eat? No. Oh, forgot to eat. Krishna, Krishna, Krishna. But you should not sleep sometime. What? Krishna, Krishna, Krishna. What? Sleep. They forgot to sleep. Forgot to eat, forgot to sleep. They were so absorbed in remembering Krishna. Krishna kirtana gana nartana paro premamri tambo nidhi. They were constantly engaged in Krishna utkirtan, not in Krishna kirtan. Krishna utkirtan. Very loud. Utkirtan, yes. Loud kirtan. And through that Krishna utkirtan, Krishna kirtana gana nartana, they were chanting. And nartana, dancing also. Yes, chanting, dancing, and emerged in an ocean of transcendental love. Ah, yes. When we love, when love is very strong, then one can do anything, forget anything, one can be totally absorbed. And Srila Rupa and Sanatana Goswami were absorbed. Therefore, the bhakti that they displayed is not the common bhakti of the common man who is doing everything out of kartavya. Kartavya, the religious duty. Kartavya to hai. Jarur. Kartavya anusar na pariya. Bilkul. It is very important. Yes, must follow this duty. But no, it went, as they say, beyond the call of duty. And this is the nature of true bhakti. True bhakti goes beyond the call of duty. It is done out of love. You see a grandfather, and the grandfather has his grandchildren, and he is going to spoil them. That is his business. That's his plan. That's what he does. That's what grandparents do. See, to be a parent means you get all the trouble. To be a grandparent means you get all the fun. Grandparents, they have to correct their kids, chastise them, sit still, behave properly. How can you speak like this? This is not correct. Grandparents go here. You take this, oh thank you, yes. Grandparents are the best. Yes, in my family, somehow or other my mother, under the influence of the commercials, was convinced that margarine was healthier than butter. So she was serving out this margarine. Now, as a kid, I went on strike. I'm not eating this. I refused. And I won the battle. And then every day my grandmother came and brought a packet of butter for me. And it was my butter. And my brother and sister could not touch it. It was my very tasty butter. The best. Yes, grandparents are like that. And why is it so? They do so out of love. Out of love. Out of love, one can do anything. A man works so hard. When he's really in love, he works hard, and 1 month's salary he spends on a ring. All month's salary on one ring. Please take. Oh yes, I bought a little ring for you. with a gift.
Oh, a diamond.
Like this, loving exchanges. How much greater are the loving exchanges on the spiritual platform? How much more absorbing? We cannot imagine. We cannot imagine. But when we hear how Srila Rupa and Sanatan Goswamis were absorbed, so much absorbed, then we get an idea. An idea. When we hear how Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was absorbed and how he mistook the Ganga for the Yamuna, then we get an idea. The same happened in Jagannath Puri when he saw the ocean. He saw the ocean again. He goes, Yamuna. I mean, you know, you had that here in Melbourne when you saw the sea that you just jumped in and said, hey, Yamuna. I don't think so. It's more like... But Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu mistook the ocean for the Yamuna. And he was floating in the ocean. When he was ecstatic in full love of God, it is said sometimes the limbs in his body would come loose from the joints. Yeah. Anybody ever had that while chanting? I guess we are still in the beginner stage. But in the very advanced stages, that can happen. The limbs come loose. Don't worry. It comes back together also. So anyway, but because of that, the body of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was floating in the ocean and it had become very long. He was already tall. He was practically over 2 meters tall. It's at 7 cubits, it says in the scriptures, about 7 feet. So that's 2 meters 10. So that's quite long, especially in India, but people are a little shorter than in Europe or something like that. So that's very tall. Very tall. So he was already very tall, and then the joints came loose, then he was over 3 meters tall. And he was floating in the water. And because he was floating in the ocean for a long time, his body became white. Then a fisherman caught a big, big fish in his net. Oh, the catch of my life. Every fisherman is always hoping. And he pulled in the net, and then this big white creature was inside, and somehow the fisherman touched it, and that it's this creature made a horrible sound. He touched it, and then he felt possessed, possessed by this being. He felt the power overtaking him, and he was very, very afraid. And he started, and he felt the power of that being, and he's jumping, and it's like, I'm possessed, Krishna, Krishna. He was chanting at the same time. Then Swarup Damodar Goswami found him. And in between chanting, dancing, and jumping, the fisherman said, I'm possessed by a ghost. But Swarup Damodar could understand that he had seen Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And Swarup Damodar said, oh, I am an exorcist. I know a mantra by which I can free you from the ghost. And he took him and he slapped him in the face a few times. And then the fisherman became a little more calm, still chanting Krishna, 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 but no longer jumping like mad. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna, Krishna. Then Swarup Damodar said, it was not a ghost. It was Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. No, I've seen the Lord many times. It was not him. Yes, it's him. It was him, but this time in the ecstatic state. Then all the devotees went to see Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. They chanted in his ear, and then all the joints came back together. Don't ask me how these things happen. You have to have faith. Some faith has to be there. Faith that there is more than we know. Faith that there is more than we can see with the bare eye. Faith that there is more than the everyday experience. That faith has to be there. Otherwise, avajanati mam muda. The muda will never understand Manusintanumasvitam, you think I'm an ordinary human being, Krishna says. Yes. He cannot believe in anything greater than everyday reality. Cannot be. People don't have loose joints, and if your joints are loose, then you need to go to a hospital. No, that's not actually intelligent. Intelligence is to accept that there are many things that are greater than our intelligence. Isn't the universe greater than our intelligence? Aren't there many laws of nature that go beyond the human mind? Isn't time greater than human intelligence? How long is our lifespan compared to the lifespan of the universe? So, we see amongst Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his associates, we see that they are great and deep ecstatic devotees, that they at the same time are very learned in scripture. Jiva Goswami wrote 400,000 verses. Rupa Goswami wrote 100,000 verses, quoting from so many shastras left and right, and they had no computers. The Goswamis used to write books on palm leaves, and they used to write on both sides of the palm leaf. So they were writing on part on side one, then they let that dry, then they start to write on number three, then when one was dry they turn it around, then they write on two. Like this. Very intelligent, very systematic, very learned, very great scholars. Rupa and Sanatan were such great scholars. Even before, when they were still ministers of the Nawab Hussein Shah, they lived in the district Malda in North Bengal, not far from Bihar actually. And there in that district was the capital of the Muslim ruler, and about 20 kilometers outside is the village known as Ramakeli, where Rupa and Sanatan resided. And there they had a palace, and they had many cottages on the bank of the Ganga. And many scholars of their time came, were invited to stay there. All brahmanas came, stayed there, and were educated and trained in scripture. And daily there were big discussions. So Rupa and Sanatan were very learned, very, very learned. They were not sentimentalists, just all day, Krishna, 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 no. They were extremely deep and learned in scripture at the same time. But they had fully realized that scripture. They were not dry pandits. Sansara sangane janma mritya chalrahe. Everyone is sleeping. Everyone is sitting here thinking, when is it finished? But they go to the satsang for the asirvad. But when Rupa and Sanatan would speak, everyone would come. When such great devotees speak, people would assemble from everywhere to hear. Everyone. Everyone wanted to spend time with them. Sanatan Goswami was so wise, everyone in Vrindavan would ask him any question. If there was a question, it didn't matter what question, go and ask Sanatan Goswami. Yes. Remember? Jaya Radhe, Jaya Krishna, Jaya Vrindavan. Jaya Krishna, Jaya Vrindavan. Jaya Radhe, Jaya Krishna, Jaya Vrindavan. No. Came to Sanatan Goswami. First, that deity had been worshipped by a Brahmana in Mathura, but that worship was very spontaneous because this Brahmana would treat the deity like one of his children. He had all the children sitting in a line, and then he would feed them, and then the deity also. And when Sanatan Goswami came to the house of that Brahmana once, he saw that, he said, "That's not proper. You have to worship the deity according to the Shastra. You cannot worship him." Oh. That night, the Brahmana had a dream and said that, "For long I stayed with you, but now I want to go under the care of my devotee, Sanatan Goswami." So, at the same time, Sanatan Goswami also had a dream. And in that dream, the deity told him that he should go to that house and take care. So Sanatan came, collected the deity, brought the deity to Vrindavan, but he had no facility and he did not want to put the deity on the ground. So therefore he decided with cloth to hang the deity in the tree, so it was at least not on the ground because he didn't have a temple. Then he had a dream again, and the deity said, "Actually, I was very happy with that Brahmana. It was very nice. He was taking care of me in such a nice way. But now I'm with you." So then Sanatan Goswami was living very simple. He would just beg, get little atta, make a ball, make it flat, throw it in the ashes in the fire, and then cook that. And that was it. So he offered that to the deity. So one day Madan Mohan said, "Could I get a little salt, please?" So then, you know, Sanatan Goswami says, "What is this? You know, we are renunciants. And you are asking for salt? Today is for salt, tomorrow this, that. No, we are living simple life. No. We cannot afford this." So shortly after that, there was a big storm and a ship on the Yamuna got stuck on the bank and was in trouble. Later the owner asked the local people if they knew something about the banks in the river and which way to pull. They said, "Oh, we don't know. Ask Sanatan Goswami, he knows everything." So then Sanatan Goswami told them exactly how to do it and which way to pull, and it worked. So then after the owner of the ship came, his name was Kapoor, and Kapoorji came and asked Sanatan Goswami what kind of reward, what he wanted. Sanatan Goswami said, "No, I don't want anything, I don't need anything, but if you want to do something, you can do something for Madan Mohan. Why don't you make a temple for this, for them?" So Kapoor agreed, and in this way Madan Mohan, who were hanging in the tree, got their temple. And of course, what was in the boat?
Salt.
See, he got his salt. All right, so this is a famous story. But we see how intimately they were relating to the deity of Krishna. The deity was speaking to them. How simple they lived and how Krishna arranged everything. Because they had full faith. If one has full faith in Krishna, then Krishna will arrange everything. But if we have half faith in Krishna, then Krishna will arrange half. We don't believe that Krishna will take care, and therefore we think, "No, if I don't take care of myself, then who will take care?" We cannot walk around all day and chant Krishna, Krishna, Krishna. How will we eat? But if we have full faith, we will eat. We will eat. But who has that faith? Rupan Sanatan had. They had that kind of faith. We see that in the devotees of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So now we live in the modern times. The same movement, the same tradition, but it is a little different. It started with Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, the spiritual master of Srila Prabhupada. He made the beginning for the modern world. He was driving in a car. This is like 1935. So, in a car.
Before even, a bit before.
A little earlier than 1930 maybe. Driving in a car, having an overcoat, a sadhu wearing sewn cloth. Sadhus were not wearing sewn cloth. Sitting with an overcoat, driving in a car. Some people were criticizing him. He said, what kind of sadhu is this? Is he a follower of the Goswamis? The Goswamis, they lived so simple under the trees, and now look at this. Is he a follower of the Goswamis? And then Sanatan Goswami, someone sat behind him. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta turned around and said, yes, a follower of the Goswamis. One who takes up the same mission of the Goswamis. Not one who is just imitating the Goswamis. Because the Goswamis did not just live under trees. The Goswamis wrote books. And those books became the foundation of this movement. And in this way, the Goswamis were preaching. And Srila Bhakti Siddhanta was preaching very strongly. And he laid the foundation for what we have now. This modern Krishna, this modern movement. Because Srila Bhakti Siddhanta reminded us of the philosophy of Srila Rupa Goswami. Anashaktasyanvisyam yataran upajunjataha nirbandha krishna sambandha yukta vairagya uchate. He's saying that simply we are detached, but we take all the things of this world and use them for the service of Krishna. And then it can all be done. Then you can sit all day, computer, for Krishna. Or you can drive car for Krishna. Or, you know,
hello.
You can have latest form, latest, best. Swami's always have best forms. So like this, we are now living in the modern times, using all the modern things, but for Krishna. Then there is no need to live under a tree. One can have a nice house, but the house must be for Krishna. The house must be a holy place. The house must be filled with worship of Krishna. Everything in the house must be offered to Krishna. Everything. Everything must be pure. Whatever we watch must be Krishna, Krishna, Krishna. We must see Krishna. Just like Krishna himself, when he lived in Dwarka, what Krishna would do in the morning, when he opened his eyes, he would see auspicious things, like statues of cows, and things like that. So one must fill the house with auspiciousness so that one sees auspicious things. I used to have a friend in India called Mr. Gupta in Indore, and Gupta had a business. He was selling truck parts, you know. So in India, many truck drivers are sadars, right? So all day these sadars would come and fight with him over the price of the truck parts. But then if you go to his shop, right? There was one thing. Wherever you looked, there were pictures of Krishna. Everywhere. Mr. Gupta had pictures of Krishna on the everywhere on the table, on the walls, on the ceiling, on the door, on the doorknob, on his pen, on his watch. Anywhere you could put a picture of Krishna, Gupta had a picture of Krishna. So one day I asked Gupta, I said, Guptaji, why do you have so many pictures of Krishna? He said, well, I might just forget Krishna, just in case I forget him to remind me. Yeah, pictures of Krishna. So the spirit, the Gupta spirit is what we need. This Gupta spirit is a great secret. Gupta means hidden, right? The Gupta spirit, the hidden spirit, or the secret spirit, the Gupta spirit is this spirit. We might just forget Krishna, so let's make all the arrangements we can to remember him. Then we can live in this modern world, and then we can work in jobs. Every time I give a lecture, I get the same question. Swamiji, how is it possible in this time during work and all these things to remember Krishna? Well, this question I have answered for you today. So you cannot ask the question now. Today you cannot ask this question. I'm sorry. It's already answered, right? Just, it's the Gupta spirit, right? Just the Gupta formula, that will do it. Formula one, just that spirit. Yeah. What else should I tell them? I think I'll tell you the story of the opening of the Delhi temple, because I think you will like it. You know, at that time, the Prime Minister of India was going to come to the newly constructed temple to open the temple. It's a big thing when the Prime Minister comes. I mean, you know, the government came in and the whole neighborhood, they cleaned the streets. I've never seen anything like it. In all of India, I have never seen the streets so clean. They can do it if they want to. They did it. So streets were very clean and everything was first class. Then what happened was, then they came to screen the temple with security forces. So they sent black cat commandos. That's the best in India, black cat commandos. And they had black cat commandos with German shepherd dogs checking out the place. So I saw them on the roof, checking out the roof. Next moment my room opened and the dog walked straight in, sniffed me, and apparently I passed the test. They came also with bomb detectors, metal detectors, everything. Everything was all right. So I was cleared and I got a VVIP badge. I was cleared. So I could be there. Others could not be, only selected few could be in the temple. And some people were very eager to be in the picture with the Prime Minister. All the time. But when the Prime Minister spoke, he said something that was interesting. He said, yes, today in this temple, everyone is very excited. He said, everyone is very excited because of all the VIPs that are here, right? And of course, you know, especially because some major VIPs have come, and some people may feel that yes, today the most important person in the entire country is here. And he says, and that is the truth. On this day, indeed, the most important person in the entire country is here, namely Sri Krishna. And by saying that, he did very good. What can I say? By saying that to the world, he did something that a head of state is meant to do. When Yudhisthira Maharaj was the ruler of the world, he used the Rajasuya sacrifice to establish that Krishna is the Supreme Lord. And Vajpayee used the BJP to establish that Krishna is the Supreme Lord. For that, he'll get the mercy. That was not a small thing for a prime minister to say. Not a small thing. So, yeah, something good in India today. Something. Not everything, but something. Something good, we must say. I also liked it when Russia was having this court case against Prabhupada's Bhagavad Gita, and they wanted to ban it. And then the Indian Parliament became very upset, and very upset. There was a riot in the Parliament. Big objections were there, and they had to adjourn the Parliament because there was an uproar. India would not accept it. And then, you know, there used to be a James Bond film, right, called From Russia with Love, right? So Amul Butter made a big advertisement billboard, and on there they showed one Indian person presenting Bhagavad Gita to a Russian, you know, the hat, etc., and it says To Russia with Love. I have that picture. It's a good picture. Yes. So these are the things that spirit should be there. The Bhagavad Gita is ours. But not just a glorious past. The Bhagavad Gita is a glorious present. The Bhagavad Gita is still the essence in our life today. That's it. And if we can do that, if we can live our life by the Bhagavad Gita, wherever we are, then everything will become saubhagya, auspicious, everything. All inauspiciousness will disappear. So now we have used up some of the time. Of course, I came quite late due to traffic. So now I'll just to bring it back to some sweetness, we'll sing for a few more moments, and then we will hear a question or two. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna.
Hey, Karthik, slow.
It will go fast soon enough. Hare Krishna.
Krishna, Krishna, Hare.
Thank you.
Is young, so they say. So that's in Spain, they say like that. I'm not sure, it's joven, the night is young. And then it's midnight and the night just begins. Why not? When Rupa and Sanatan would forget to sleep, we may not forget, but we must still for a moment answer some of your questions. I gave you some time to think, so if there are any questions or comments, then I will try to answer those. Okay, the written ones are coming. Who we are, why we were born. In the scripture, it is said there is, first of all, there is Swayam Bhagavan Krishna, and then Parashya Shakti Vividaira Shruyate. There are many different energies emanating from Krishna. One of these energies is the living being. It is said the living being is a chitkana, or a tiny part and parcel of Krishna. Bhagavad Gita also says, Mamayvam so jiva loke. So the jiva, the living being, is a tiny part and parcel of Krishna, like a spark from a fire. So we are Krishna's energy. And why we were born? We were born in this world because we desired to be independent from the Lord. We were here to be king. And every man is a king. And every lady a queen. And we are living like kings in our palaces. And we have our coaches in front of the house, drawn by many horses. I don't know how many horsepower your car has, but, you know. And we are having royal breakfast every morning. What you're having? Are you having oranges from River Rhine, or are you having the oranges flown in from Europe? Or no, I prefer the South American ones, actually. I like them better. Yeah. Like this, we live like kings. Even kings never lived as royal as we do today. We have everything in our palaces. So that's why we came here, because we wanted that. We did not want to serve the Lord. But we forgot that the real happiness is not in these material things. That real happiness is only found actually in our true position as being a servant. Because Jivira Sarupha, the eternal position of the living being, is to be the servant of God. Krishna Nitya Das, to be the eternal servant of Krishna. So that's the only way we can be satisfied. And until then, nobody will be satisfied. Not even in Mumbai. Sorry. You explained the Yukta Vairagya, but how do we know how much is too much for an individual? Thank you. A Vaishnava is never alone. See, a Vaishnava is always engaged in the service of another Vaishnava, a superior Vaishnava. And it is the superior Vaishnavas that will set the limits for us. No one can set the limit for himself, but by serving our superiors, they will set the limits. And in that way it's possible. Just like it's very difficult to put yourself on a diet. You know, every man knows it's hard to put yourself on a diet, but when your wife puts you on the diet, then what can you do? Then it's very easy. Okay, more questions. What is the purpose of God? Why has He created all the living beings? Scribble, scribble. And even the spiritual world. Well, the thing is this. The purpose of God is to enjoy the greatest happiness. The greatest happiness is found in loving exchange. Oh. Therefore, the Supreme Lord is engaging in loving relationships with every living being. And his purpose is to increase that loving relationship eternally. And this is actually the spiritual world. Here in the material world, our love has turned away from God, and our love has turned for ourselves and our possession, I and mine. This is illusion. So the process of sadhana is purifying us from our greed, our lust, our anger, and then it awakens our original love for God. When that's awakened, then we understand that what we're looking for in this world is small pleasure compared to the pleasure that is there in serving the Lord. So in this way, the living being can be either here in the material world or in the spiritual world. Next question, how can one develop full faith in Lord Krishna? Step by step. Step by step. Each time, take another step towards Krishna, even if it's scary. See, it's always, we have fear to surrender. But, all right, the next step, let's do it anyway. And if we do, then we gain more faith. And then there's another step. And still we have fear. But each time we overcome our fear in taking a step closer to Krishna and fulfilling his desire, each time we gain more faith, and with it, more happiness. When I worship, instead of remembering Krishna, I remember Maya only. Why? We are conditioned souls. Bahu janmanamante gyanavaman prapadinte vasudeva savamiti. After many, many lives, we finally come to the point where we accept that Krishna is everything. So what did we do in all those other lives? We were involved with the material energy. Therefore, we carry this with us. Many lives of being influenced, being by the material energy. We've developed deep attachments over many lives. When someone has a lot of greed, money, 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 then for many lives he's chased after money. Therefore it's very deep, even in a child. It is there, greed. So, therefore, when we worship, we remember only Maya because of previous conditioning. But if we continue to worship, then gradually it will get better and better. And we'll start to remember Krishna. Abhyasa yogi yuktena cheti sananya gamana purusam. Is abhyas. Abhyas means practice. Everything is about abhyas. Regular practice. Then it will change. Cool. Finished. Yes.
Krishna is the only one who can give us liberation, no other God?
No other God. Vishnu cannot give liberation, but only Krishna or his expansions, such as Vishnu or Narayan, they can give liberation.
Another thing I heard, like those who follow the Shiv and go to the Shiv Lok, they also not born again.
No, that's not correct. No. Where is Kailash? Where is Kailash? Mount Kailash, where Krishna is, where Shiva is residing. Where is that? Actually, if you read the scripture, you will see that it is situated on the bank of the river Viraja. The Viraja river is the river which is between Haridam and Devidam. Devidam is material world, Haridam spiritual world. In between is the Viraja. On the bank, on the material side, on the material side of the Viraja, that means on the Devidam side, there is Kailash. the abode of Lord Shiva. So, what do we attain? The spiritual side or the material side? Then, yes, no liberation. Then we are still on this side of the Viraja. So, it's not based on scripture if people say like that. Other questions? Because like I said before, we have been conditioned for a long time, and then we've become attached to the material energy. So we are afraid to give up that security. It's funny, it's just like your family. You know, I don't know your family, I know my family. But somehow or other, families stay together. Eh? Now, you know, if you speak about the truth in every family, you know, then it's not all just beautiful. Yes? I mean, I don't know your family, but I know my family. And I know very well. But still we stay together, because my point was, a known evil is better than an unknown evil. You know what I mean? So like this, you know, we hold on to all these things. You know, someone who's born in Melbourne is thinking, well, you know, Melbourne is better than anywhere else because I know Melbourne. Meanwhile, you're freezing to death. But just because we know the place, we are attached. So this is it. So surrender to Krishna looks like a step into the unknown. What? See, I have one little drama which I have performed several times. I can perform it just because not everyone has seen it. But basically, the idea is that I have... the house is not new, and the rains have been coming, and we are not having enough pots and pans anymore to catch all the water that is coming through the roof. So it's becoming a problem. So today is a sunny day, so today I will fix the roof. That's high. Oh, thank God. Oh, I'm saved. I managed to grasp the edge of the roof. Oh God. Phew, that was close. Too much prasadam on the Sunday feast. And no exercise. I cannot pull myself up on the roof. Oh no. How long can I hang here on the edge of the roof? Oh no. I'm gonna fall anyway. How long can I hold myself? Oh God, oh God. Oh God, please save me.
Need any help?
Who are you?
I am God.
Oh God, oh God, please save me. Oh God.
All right, I will save you.
Oh, yes, my Lord, please save me.
All right, let go of the roof
and I will catch you. Can't you catch me first and then I'll let go of the roof? This is the problem. So we're holding on to our roof and we're afraid to let go. And this way we say, well, give me the ecstasy first, then I'll let go. That's where we're afraid of the next step. Anyone? Yes?
So how have you overcome that spirit?
Jump. Into Krishna consciousness. Yep. Just jump into it. Yes.
What is the meaning of Om? Like you start all the spiritual things. Om
Namo Bhagavate. Om. Okay. Om is actually the very root of all the Vedic mantras. The true Mahavakya is Om, actually. The real essential word in all the Vedic literature is Om. It is the first word. And what is it? Om, the meaning of Om is it includes everything. Everything that is. Om is referring to everything that exists, everything that is manifest. Therefore, Om is referring to the Supreme Lord, because ultimately, the Supreme Lord is everything. He is the source of everything. He is everything. I'm the origin of everything. And everything rests in me. Just as it says in the Bhagavad Gita, Mata Parataram Nanyat, it is said that Sutra Mani Ganai Va, just like everything in this world is like pearls strung on a thread. Sutra Mani Ganai Va. I am the string that connects everything and everything. So the Supreme Lord is ultimately addressed by Om. So when we begin a mantra with Om, a prayer with Om, we begin to make the sambandha, to make the connection. We are normally covered by the material modes of nature. And we are thinking, oh, I'm struggling here, or this is so nice, and that is a problem, and oh, this is good. We are struggling with the modes of material nature. But when we chant Om, stop. Stop that now. Focus for a moment on the spiritual, on the all-pervading spiritual energy of the Lord. Om. And reconnect with the spiritual platform. Therefore, sambandha. Sambandha. Then when we chant Om Namo, Namaha, not mine. Na, not mine. Namaha. So surrender. Om Namo. I'm surrendering now. Yes? Not for me, but for you, my Lord. Om Namo. Bhagavate. Bhagavan, the Supreme Lord, relating to the Supreme Lord, the Son of Vasudeva. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudeva. So we begin with making this spiritual connection. Then we overcome the I and mine tendency in ourselves. Then we focus on the Supreme Lord, Sri Krishna. Like this we pray. But Om always reconnects us. And because we forget it again and again, you know, you come out very spiritual out of a satsang, and then you come home and you read the bills. Yeah? Forget everything. Yes. And then next time again, Om. Oh yeah. Okay. All right. Yeah. There's more than bills in this world. TK. Okay. So I think the last question.
Maharaj, I just want to understand the difference between free will and destiny.
Yes.
And does one precedes the other?
Mm-hmm. So it is. There's a verse. Tasyaiva hita prayate te kovido. Talabhyate upariyada. That actually the wise know that in this life we are simply going upwards in the universe or downwards in the universe according to the reactions of our activities. In that way, things are completely predestined. If you show me your hand, I can see many things in your hand for you. I can see if there is only one marriage, I can see. It shows. The number of children, we can see. We can see. Such things. Mm-hmm. 1 minute, huh? So we can see. So that's destiny. The Jyotis, the astrologer, he can calculate many things. And if he's a good astrologer, he can tell you many things about your life. That is all true. So in that way, how is that? Because when we are under the influence of karma, things are predestined by karma. Yeah? We make predictable choices. And the choices you got are simply the choices you got by your karma. You have some clothes, I have some clothes. You got by your karma some variety. I got by my karma. Yeah, everyone gets something. Yeah? And we think we make choices, but actually we get by our karma. So that's the predestined element. Mm-hmm. But then when we take to the spiritual path, when we decide to serve Krishna, then Krishna gives destiny into our hands. At that stage, one rises above this predestined element, and one can actually take his destiny in hand by whatever we do towards the Lord. Therefore, whatever seva you do for the Lord, that changes your destiny. Everything else, punya and pap, punya and pap. You give to a poor man, you get some punya. Yeah? You steal from someone else, you get some pap. Yeah? But when you give to the Lord, then more and more your destiny comes in your own hand.
So does that mean destiny can be changed, or is it changeable?
It is changeable if you take up the service of the Lord. Otherwise you are caught up in a network of karma.
But then how do you differentiate that the choices you are making, as you rightly mentioned, that they are predetermined choices based on your karmic activity?
No, you have some independence. Within your karma, you have within the range of your karma, you can make some choices.
How do you differentiate that your free will, or that's your predetermined choices?
Yeah, you have a minute independence, right? A minute independence. You can walk on one side of the street or on the other side of the street, but you have to walk in the street, right? You cannot change the street so easily, for example, right? You can, nowadays, we can travel now, so many things, we can change country, we can change easily, but still, we are limited. So within we have some minute independence, and with that some responsibility for our actions, otherwise there would be no actions, otherwise we just say, well, if God makes me surrender, I will surrender. So there is a minute independence, but the circumstances are not under our control. They are controlled by karma, you see. You have no influence on, you may work so hard, but what you'll get depends on your karma, not on your work. The success of your labor will depend on your karma. That you cannot change. But you can choose to do pious things or impious things. That you can do. So in some there is a minute independence, but you cannot change much of your destiny by your labor.
So that, in a way, then there is no free will.
Not much, little, minute. Minute free will. There is free will, minute free will, minute independence. That we can make some choices. But we have very little influence on our... We have free will to make choices, but minute influence on our destiny. So it virtually has so little effect, it's almost negligible. Until you begin to serve the Lord. Because then you get the grace of the Lord. Then it changes your destiny. See? All these choices we make, See, it's like, one time I was in the Netherlands. Now, the Netherlands makes Melbourne weather look good, yeah? It always rains, and it's cold. So I was walking there in the cold rain, feeling totally miserable. Next moment, I saw a poster of a beach in a shop somewhere, and I had already bought the ticket before I knew it. And then I came to Kenya in Africa. I went to the beach. I was young. I was thinking this will be great. I sat down, but the beach was very hot. Then I sat under the palm tree. From the palm tree, a scorpion dropped. So I'm looking, whoa, scorpion, good story to tell back home, you know? I fought with the scorpion. But then another scorpion. So then I decided, oops, the trees are full of scorpions. This is not so good. So I'll go for a swim. I was about to go in the water and the local people said, no, no, you cannot swim. I said, I can swim. I'm from Holland. We can swim. He said, no, you cannot swim because the sharks are coming over the banks. It's high tide. You cannot swim when there's high tide. I go, oh, sharks, high tide. Okay. So I was sitting on the beach under my towel, suffering. I was destined to suffer. I was destined to suffer. I couldn't change it. I tried it, and all that I could do was move the burden from one hand to the other. Huh? It's like that's all. I moved the burden, but the burden I still had to go through. The amount of happiness you cannot change. You can change the way you get it with your independence, but you cannot change the amount of happiness and the amount of unhappiness. You see? So we're changing. You came from, you were not satisfied in India, you came to Australia. Are you any happier? In some ways, yes, some ways, no. I don't think the Australian dream has come true for anyone. You know what I'm saying? It's like, maybe in India there was a hope, you know, that the Australian dream, but the Australian dream doesn't exist because we bring the karma with us and the happiness and the unhappiness is also here. Maybe in a different way, but it is here. In this country you make so much money and you also spend so much money on so many things that you would never spend for in India. But here you're forced to name something. Yeah? So the point is, we can move the suffering from one hand to the other, yeah, by our independent choices. But we cannot change the happiness or the distress. The quantities of happiness and distress are fixed by karma, until we take up the service of the Lord. Then we get His grace, then we get a grip on the destiny.
So in a way, free will is illusionary.
Very limited, as I said, very limited, yes.
But then taking up the service of Lord, is that predetermined choice or is that a free will?
No, there is choice, there's free will. I said there's minute independence, so you make a choice. You choose to serve the Lord. You choose. But it's the point, when you're in a labyrinth, you're in a labyrinth. As long as you're inside the labyrinth, right, you can go left, you can go right, but you always wind up after the corners in some dead end, you know? Because you're in this, it's a labyrinth, right? It's designed for you to get in some dead end street. That's the way it's designed. So ultimately, all material endeavors reach a point of limitation in happiness. But when you get out of the labyrinth, then it's a different story again. So the real choice, you can make so many choices in the labyrinth. I go left, I go right. But until you say, now I'm going for the exit. Right? Only when you go out of the exit, then you know, yes. Then you can experience more happiness, increase your happiness. Otherwise, with your independent choices, you cannot increase your happiness in this world. See? The amount of happiness you're due to get, you're due to get. Pious activities give you some more happiness. Impious activities give you less happiness. That's all. And it goes up and down, up and down, up and down. Again, you go up for a while, boom, come back down. Up and down. Yeah. For sinful activities you suffer, for pious activities you enjoy. Up and down, up and down. That's all. So for that we use our independence. You can choose when you go up, when you go down. According to your pious activities. That's your only choice. So there is some independence, but it's just caught in the cycle until you serve the Lord, then you go out of the cycle. Now it's good?
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah. Try again. Some other time. Time to go. Take some prasada. And you all must be hungry. I'm not so hungry. So I will just leave now. Tomorrow I'm going to Canberra. So thank you very much. Very nice to be with you in the last evening. Try to satisfy everyone, but and ultimately in the material world we will remain caught. Get some happiness, it will not satisfy. Get some suffering according to pious and impious activity. We'll never get out of this. With all the choices we make, we're locked. Until we choose for Krishna, then we go out. So this movement is for that, and we invite everyone to partake in it. And I hope that tonight left you with some inspiration. You can see that it's a movement that goes beyond just the ordinary satsang. It's calling for more surrender to Krishna, a higher quality. And to say, yes, we're going to really make Krishna the priority. See, in the whole world, spiritual life has just become, let's get a few blessings. We go to the mosque to get a few blessings. We go to the church to get a few blessings. We go to the temple to get a few blessings so that everything in our life will go well. Basically, we think material life is fine. There is only sometimes some problems happening, and if they wouldn't happen, then we would be very happy. So we go to the temples and so on, or other religious institutions to make sure nothing happens, nothing bad happens. But the truth of the matter is in material life, is not that good. It is not. There is something better that we get from surrender to the Lord. And this movement is really calling for that. And the Bhagavad Gita is calling for that. It's calling for that surrender. So the Vaishnava Acharyas are emphasizing this, and that's been the theme of the evening, to go beyond just being religious to the point of making the Supreme Lord number one in our life. Okay. So with that, I say goodbye to you and see you again next time. Hare Krishna.